So I want to welcome you to the second of this year's Hot Topics at the Banff Mountain Film Festival. I think we've got a great conversation lined up here. Today's panel is kind of a natural extension of yesterday's. We were up here yesterday talking about near misses, accidents, injuries, and now we're very sensibly talking about rescue. The notion for the panel today is specifically to talk about Himalayan rescue and some questions that have recently come up, but I think certainly the wealth of talents and knowledge of the panel means that we'll probably be able to talk about lots of other kinds of rescues and other ranges as well, and how though the experience there might inform the future of Himalayan rescue questions as well. The idea for this panel came up primarily because of an incident that occurred in the early days of August of this year. On the 5th of August, the very well-known Slovenian mountaineer Tomaz Humar was early into an attempt on the enormous, probably the largest face in the world, the Rupal face of Nanga Parbat. He had been looking at doing the face for quite a long time from base camp. The conditions were really miserable. He wrote repeatedly in his weblog that he didn't think an ascent would be possible, and that the snow especially was dangerous and unstable and unconsolidated. But he decided anyways on about the 1st of August to head on up the mountain. By the 5th of August, he was encountering just the kind of severe conditions that he was predicting, but in the morning of the 5th of August, he wrote something that really, for him, I believe, captured what he felt was the most important issue at the time. He said, about 8 o'clock that morning, "Rescue from the middle of the Rupal face is impossible. That is what makes mountaineering special." At about 8 p.m. that night, he called for a rescue. Like a lot of issues in mountaineering, this seems like this has been kind of a touchstone issue that's very similar to other things we've covered on panels up here, like bolting, like high altitude guiding, like questions of other kinds of ethics in the mountain. And the question here really seems to be captured by a lot of the websites that cover mountaineering. They're asking questions such as, does the fact of Humar's rescue seem like a portent of bad things to come in the future? Are we really looking at a change in the way that mountaineering, especially in the high Himalaya, has practiced? Because what happened with Humar is that for the very first time, a helicopter came in and rescued somebody on a line rescue, a short line rescue. This had never happened before in the Himalaya. Helicopters had gone high, for instance, into the Western Kum for one of the evacuations during the 96 Everest disaster. Another thing that really played into the questions that are happening this year is the fact that a helicopter, very, very stripped down, very light, was landed on the summit of Everest very briefly earlier in the spring. So I think it's understandable when you see someone like Humar with that much publicity, because it was a huge media event, both on Humar's own website, but in the Pakistani military's view, the whole nation of Pakistan came behind this. There was a team of Swiss rescuers that was starting to mobilize, thinking that they should be the ones who should fly all the way from Switzerland and rescue him. It really seemed that there was a great deal of drama unfolding as a result of this. And also what happened was that when Humar was taken out, the rescue was celebrated as a huge accomplishment, both of the Pakistani military, who flew in and took him out. Quite understandably, it was an accomplishment for them, but oddly enough, also seen as an accomplishment for Humar, that he had managed to survive, that he had had this great thing happen. And that's been something that has drawn a lot of fierce commentary from various people in the media. Especially climbers have really been looking at this question and really criticizing Humar very strongly for the fact, A, that he got himself into the position in the first place, B, that he called for the rescue, and C, that he seemed to, at least to some degree, participate in him being labeled as a hero for simply having been rescued. Whether any of these things have any relevance for the future of climbing is kind of the question of the panel today. And I'm just going to introduce people, and I'll have Barry Blanchard speak a little bit as a first thought about what this means for climbing. So starting from my left here, we have Tim Auger, a very, very well-known local climber and longtime member of the Parks Canada public safety team in Banff, who's participated in lots and lots of rescues in his life. Barry Blanchard, another very well-known local character, mountain guide, and very strong alpinist, who has, as I think he said, participated in many rescues, but only one at the receiving end. Conrad Anker, one of America's finest mountaineers and very experienced in the Himalaya and with some experience of rescue himself. And Valeri Babanov, a recent emigre to Canada, now living in Calgary, very, very experienced Russian mountaineer, both in Europe and in the high Himalaya as well. So starting with you, Barry, what do you think this represents for the future of climbing?
I think, as Jeff said, it's the first time that there's been a technical rescue on a really big peak in the Himalaya, so the next person who gets in trouble over there is going to have that escape valve in the back of their mind. And to this point in time, I think, I, definitely for myself and my partners, I think I can speak for Conrad and Valerie too, that that just never was there before. You know, you never even thought in those terms. If rescue was going to come, it was going to come from other climbers who might come and try to get you down. So, yeah, I think that's going to be a psychological change in the way you approach the mountains over there. And I guess the question mark will be how much the tools can do, how high the helicopter can indeed go, and how well the people who are underneath the helicopter can go in and do their job, hooking up to someone who's injured and yanking them off. And I think the other side of the whole thing is that the other big change in mountaineering is, I think, reality TV is next.
If not already. Conrad.
Part of the allure of going to the Himalaya and climbing on these larger peaks is that you knew that there was no rescue and that it was there and it was self-sufficiency. And we've seen more and more rescues being performed, as you mentioned, in 96 and now on the Rupal face, and I think it's taken away something from the sport, knowing that that's there. When you really want to embark on a climb or a journey like that, you have to be willing to accept the consequences and be willing to, in some way or form, accept the fact that you might perish on it, but knowing that you could have a rescue and there takes that away from it. So it's the psychologically what we go into the sport for, that quest for adventure is being taken away. The other downside of it is that it was broadcast over the internet and people were following it every day with great attention. Myself, sitting in my home in Montana, I could check into the internet and it was live time. And it's as Barry said, it's reality TV, and that's not the direction that I personally think climbing should be going.
Valerie.
My opinion that when we take the internet, the TV, and we have a good connection with directly from expedition, from base camp, to, like, I had, for example, a good connection from base camp to my home in Russia when I was in Russia. Yeah, I feel more safety, I feel comfortable, but I think so we lose something, we lost, like, some adventure. So when we have connection with our family or with every people, when each day we can online receive emails, everything like that, definitely we lose some adventure of expedition. I tried to be without that, but I think it's each year it's difficult and more difficult. Especially when maybe you work with some sponsors, because if you have some like responsibility, you get some money. So they ask you, okay, we give you money, but you need to send us some emails regular from base camp. So it's really a difficult question. I would like to be in the mountain alone. Nobody knows about me, but each year internet is coming more and more. I think it looks like really bad, but this is life. So I don't know. But for my opinion, that's when we took everything, all communication, we lose something a lot.
Okay. Tim.
Well, so the adventure frontier is just keeps changing, and it's moving. It's like a tide, and you can really you can feel it today, because the frontier was at the foot of the Rupal face, and now it's a few thousand feet up the face. And then when the helicopter landed on Everest, you really have to think, well, from the point of view of the rescuer, just a reminder, you're not going to, you know, just get on the radio and call for a rescue on the top of Everest right now. The helicopter isn't really right there yet, but we know it's coming. And it's just, it's like inevitable. And, it's inevitable, isn't it?
It seems kind of self-evident that we want to try and rescue people sometimes, because it's what we do. You had mentioned, Barry, that we're the only species that does that kind of thing.
Also said I wasn't a biologist.
But we also have this other impulsion to, especially in the spirit of adventure, to try and get ourselves out of situations. I wonder if you guys could comment, and perhaps I'll start with you, Conrad, just to speak a little bit about where you think things stand right now in terms of the responsibility to the sport to be able to extract ourselves.
Mountain climbing is a relatively new thing. If we think back 200-300 years ago, life was so difficult and hard, we didn't need to put ourselves in dangerous way to have fun. And similarly, the people that live in the Himalaya, the indigenous people, they don't want to go climbing. It seems like a frivolous pursuit and a waste of quite a bit of money to put all that expense to go do those things. And the one time I got into stir, and it was, I fell down a mountain in the Alaska Range, and we skied out, and we could have called for a rescue, but we didn't, but maybe, well, anyways. But it wasn't something I wanted to be public about. I went and sat in a friend's cabin and listened to Nine Inch Nails for 2 months and ate ice cream and kind of came out of it, and that was it. But to see it paraded about on the internet was in the pleading, and to see the change that going into it, that they were saying, oh, rescues are bad, and it, the essence of climbing is to know that you can't have a rescue, and then to call for a rescue was a fair degree of duplicity in my view.
Others of you that have had experience with rescues, I wonder if you could talk a little bit about the kind of choice that Conrad was talking about making in Alaska to either get rescued or not get rescued. Valerie, do you want to?
I have some example. It's happened maybe like 4 or 5 years ago. I climbed some years. I climbed alone, solo, and I tried some new line on Grand Jura's North Face. And when I climbed, I climbed already like 600 meters, and it came a big storm. I was completely blocked on the face within a couple of days, and then I had a radio, and I contact with the refuge Le Chaux, just a few hours by walking from the north face of Grand Juras, and then a refuge contact with the helicopter service, and the helicopter service, they asked me, Valeri, if you want, we can come by helicopter in 15 minutes, and in 30 minutes you will be in Chamonix, just drink beer, sitting coffee, and I feel really bad, because you have good opportunity, you have good possibility for just, okay, you can fly, in 30 minutes I will be in Chamonix. But I feel bad if they fly and take me back from the wall after this attempt, after my ascent, I not finished the summit, I not finished the route, but really I will feel bad. And I said, no, I don't need your help. Thank you very much. But I prefer rappel down all 600 meters, maybe spend all day for you, even with a bad avalanche condition, with a snowing. But I prefer in that time, my rules, continue my adventure, because it was my choice. I was alone on the face some days, and in that time, I prefer continue my this game, and I rappel by myself. But I realized I had a good possibility to take helicopter and fly down, and then I came back as a good rappel, and next morning I came back to the shore, but I was proud a little bit about this situation, because I could keep myself on the face, and I refused this kind of suggestion, help me take me off from the face. So that's, but for example, another question, another example of when it happened in 96 was we tried to make travels on Malotze, and our leader, he was dead, and I am sure if that time we had some access for helicopter, but yeah, I understand it's not possible because it was more than 8,000 meters, but if that time we had some connection with helicopter, we could ask him if it's possible, but because it happened with our friend, he was dead, but maybe if helicopters came, maybe it didn't happen with that. So it's all time it's your choice. But when talking about the life of people, maybe it's, but when I climbed north face of Grand Jura's, I just took my responsibility by myself. And when I refused on this helicopter helping, it was my choice. But sometimes for other people, maybe we had to ask some help.
So maybe never make that choice for other people.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Barry?
I would have listened to Joy Division. I couldn't imagine 2 months of 9-inch nails. Oh, God. I don't know if you ever recover from that. But yeah, my own, I think we were chatting a bit about this, that if, 10, 15 years ago, I was writing a book about the treatise of alpinism and the philosophy thereof, I may have written that we are ultimately responsible for our own actions and we will not compromise that sacred covenant we have signed with alpinists who came before us. And hearing Valerie's story, I think I would have thrown the book off the side of Lhotse and rescued my buddy's life in a heartbeat, just like that. And I know for myself, that decision came on Howe's Peak in 1999 when I was hit by a large collapsing snow mushroom late at night, in the dark, in the cold, very narrow gully, tons and tons and tons of snow. Came down and smacked me, and it was such an immense hit that I never had a physical illusion before, that I actually, in my mind, I believed I was being scraped off the mountain, and I was waiting for free fall, and then in my mind, I was waiting for the crunches of my skeleton exploding against rocks and everything. It took a beat or two to realize, for my head to put it together, that I was still anchored to the anchor and ragdolling around, and I'd taken a really big hit, and the hit was continuing, and what screamed into my head was, oh my God, I'm never going to see Catherine again. And it's just, it was so encouraging for me to have the love come into your mind at that moment. And I'm emotional right now thinking about it, but it's scary for me to think about, because there was another cold there that's beyond the cold of the temperature. Death was there. And I could feel that guy, and I hate that guy because he's taken some of my good friends. And, I don't want to scream and shout and swear at the guy, but he really pisses me off. And I got it together from being monumentally shattered, and I rappelled down to a snow cave, and my buddies took care of me. And late that night, I woke up in the shelter of the snow cave, and snow caves in that situation are on very small ledges, and they're on the sides of very precipitous mountains, and there's a storm going on outside, and I started worrying about dying. And the fear of death was very immediate and just so scary. And it's so, I realized that I'm going to leave this big black hole in the world if I die, and which was a revelation for me, because 10 years before, it's like, yeah, whatever, kill me. But, you're connected with, you owe love to so many people in your lives, and so many people love you. And I think that is the covenant now to bring back down. And I thought about calling for a rescue right then, and the radio wouldn't work. So the next day, I had a broken leg, and we were hopping down the rappels, and all the way I was worried about traverses that we would have to do, although my friend Steve House engineered a fall line sequence of rappels that kept that situation from developing. But I knew I couldn't ski the bottom of the route. I was going to have to ski a number of miles through some, you know, tiger country, some real skiing, and I knew I just couldn't do it. That fear was there, but also the fear of losing control during the rappels because of the injury and dying was there. And I tried the radio once, and it worked. Like, snow had been driven into the crystal of the radio. The guy in Calgary gave me a new radio, said, I've never seen this before. And I clicked the push-to-talk button, and I talked to a good friend right over here, Gord Irwin, and he said, you know, it's Gord. And I said, how are you doing? And that was the instant. And the whole decision was right there, and I just said, we could really use some help getting off Howes Peak. And he just said, we'll be there right away. And Gord Irwin and Mark Ludwig over there, the guys who look like they're in a hockey team. slung in and got my broken butt off of Howes Peak and left my two buddies there to down climb. So, thank you, gentlemen.
Now, Barry, the old covenant that you're talking about would suggest that somehow you would have been, to use an odd word, but it's a word we use in the community a lot, you would have been more successful if you had gotten yourself off that. Is that in any way true?
I think, I don't know. In certain situations, I think in the geographically, possibly, and I'll enter another thought into here, that perhaps in Pakistan, possibly, because the pilots over there that did that rescue of Tomas are heroes. They went out of their envelope. They don't operate in that. You know, they're good mountain flyers, but they don't go in and sling people off mountains. And these gentlemen over here and this gentleman beside me, you know, they're part of our culture and our community here, and they're some of the best in the world at it. And, in the long yard, yeah, we would have been more successful had we bared on with the rappel and then strapped me to skis and hauled me out over the snow. But in the other side of it, you know, we put up a new route on Howes Peak, and a lot of climbers view that as success, but all three of us on that climb view it as a failure because we climbed up into a storm, and we shouldn't have done that, and we paid the price for that, you know. Ultimately, our trip to Howes Peak's a failure. Right? Although I hate those terms, success and failure, what stupid things, eh? Yeah, all life happens in here, you know? It's so, I don't know, it doesn't make sense to me to think of success and failure.
Tim, I wonder if you could talk about this issue, the ethical concerns or the decisions that get made by the rescuers.
Well, I guess I'd make a distinction between the rescuing that's being done kind of impromptu and the rescuing that's being done by people who are being paid and are trained and are practicing doing it. And so when you are in that position, which is what we are, it's, I hate to sound trite, but it's just another day at work, usually. I mean, I admit that you come home and if it got exciting, you get to, add it to the, you know, your story, just like everybody else. What I'm thinking is back to, the Humar thing here and what you just said about the pilots in Pakistan. They're not ready for real rescue there. They have, it turns out that there's a lot of helicopters in the area. So it's going to be, the potential is really there, but you probably shouldn't be doing it very much, or you won't last very long if you aren't doing it on a regular basis. And I don't know if the folks here followed that story enough to, because it just sort of tapered out at the end or trickled out at the end that the actual evacuation of the fellow, it worked, it got him off, it looked like it went pretty smoothly. But Mark tells me that at the ICAR meeting this year, they had somebody brought in the footage, you know, of course there's people around, there's cameras and so on, and in the helicopter subcommission in the ICAR, they looked at what happened on the situation there, and it was a grainy. Mark tells me the film is very grainy. It's very distant. You know, the helicopter's more like a speck, but you can see it hovering. And he told me that the hovering lasts in the video for about 5 to 10 minutes. There's something wrong there if they're having to hover that close for that long. It means they're not doing it right. And the guy who's showing the thing is saying, and if you watch very carefully here, at a certain point, you can see that there's something happening, and the helicopter is now trying to lift off. And you can see it moving slightly, and then everything sort of freezes, and then all of a sudden, right at this point, you can see something happen. There it is, and what they're looking at is the fact that Humar had not disconnected from the anchor on the mountain, but he was attached to the helicopter, and in the helicopter, that meant that he was ready to lift off, and the pilot starts pulling on the controls, and he's tied to the mountain. And so what actually happened was, fortunately, was the whatever it was that was clipping him into the ice screw broke, which is, I mean, what could have broken was something else in the system.
Yeah.
Or maybe it wouldn't have broken at all. Anyway, they were looking at a total failure there, which is euphemism. What in fact happened when it broke was the Humar took off like, I don't know, on a rubber band and went flying straight towards the helicopter. And they talked to the pilots, and the Swiss pilots looked at it and they said, you know, it really did look like this. It was would have been a possibility that he would have gone right through at least the tail rotor. And that would have been it. So it's more than just a helicopter and somebody willing to fly it. They had talked about the issue of him disconnecting and making sure he did. But I mean, the way we would have done it, and the Europeans would do it, is there's somebody else on the end of the rope that actually goes in and is always there, so that there's crew on the bottom who's going to, you know, prevent that sort of thing. And so next year you can call for a rescue, but it's still a pretty risky deal. It's going to be an adventure anyway.
Conrad, one of the biggest concerns about this whole issue is whether it's a slippery slope, whether the precedent of the helicopter rescue in 96 on Everest or this rescue in Nanga Parbat is going to mean a change in, maybe to the extent that now there's going to be a possibility, a stated possibility. What kinds of things have you seen about the dangers of people knowing that there are rescues available?
To look at rescues available in a cragging type situation, we'll use Yosemite for an example. In the 60s, it wasn't possible for a rescue. It was the Camp 4 guys. They'd run up and hopefully wrap off and meet you there and take care of you. And now there's a federally funded rescue team with Werner Brown, who knows every tree on top, and they've got all their ropes together, and people are rescued yearly. It's not uncommon. And they've been rescues in storms. There's been a rescue for dehydration. Obviously accidents where people take a big whipper and break their legs and things like that. But the difference is that in Yosemite, which on El Cap, aside from the vanguard of young, strong free climbers, most of it is just scary carpentry. So you're up there taking little small pieces of metal and hammering them into the rock and scaring the daylights out of yourself. And if you whip, you can take really hurt yourself. And with that knowledge in there, the talk in the cafeteria, which is sort of the hub, the nexus of Yosemite climbing community, it's always like, oh yeah, we're in the valley. We can do that stuff. We can run it out on A4 hooks to A5 copperheads and all this stuff. But climbers probably wouldn't be doing that same degree of difficulty in Baffin Island, where a rescue would not be possible, or the Himalaya, something like that. And I would hate to see that same sort of mindset extend over to the climbs that people do in the Himalaya, because that should be our, it's the one last best place we have for cutting edge extreme alpinism that is really challenging and means something to community. And we have to preserve that for the next generation. So doesn't, I mean, you don't want to go bolt everything and put ropes up everything, but it also means keeping that psychological sense of adventure there.
Mm-hmm. Valeri, I wonder if you could think for a minute about, if you knew, if you're going back to the Himalaya and you knew that there was a possibility of a rescue, would that be something that you would carry in your back pocket as something that would change what you're doing in the kind of way that Conrad's talking about happening in Yosemite? Does it make a difference to know that?
I think so. When I, even for example, this next year I go back to Himalaya, even I, my choice will be something to climb alone, solo. When I look back, I never thought about some rescue, especially about some helicopter rescue, because I thought it's not possible. Yes, I knew somewhere when it was 96 on Everest, the helicopter could approach like on Humber Icefall, but not more. But from Humber Icefall to Everest, you have to climb by yourself, and especially if something happened with you, you have no choice. Just it's your game, so your game, you have to rescue by yourself. So for me it's no changing. Even if next year I go to Himalaya alone or with some partner, I think I still thinking like there is no rescue, there is no possibility. Just maybe in a base camp, but usually when you're in base camp, you can use the porters. If you have some broke legs or something like that, you can use the porters to get to town or like that. But I am sure if I climb next year something like climb before in the Himalaya, I never think about rescue using helicopter. And for me, it was really surprising what happened with Tomaz this year. It's unbelievable.
And is it partly unbelievable because you're surprised that someone would even ask for it? Is that part of the disbelief?
It's unbelievable that it's possible from such kind of face, like from Rupal face. I think if I go, I never thinking about that. It just it's my opinion.
Good. yet we know, I think, that there are some changes that have happened already. And Conrad, backstage, you were talking about, for instance, in some of your trips to Antarctica, that you've seen people ask for rescues in situations that you think have some moral objection to them.
Yeah, climbing or adventures in Antarctica are very costly undertakings. And it's you have to line up your sponsors or be part of an oil concern or something to afford these trips. And so they go down there, and this one instance, the group had made it to the South Pole. Their goal was to walk across the continent, and they went a little bit further. And then because they were insured, that they then got in there and then called for a rescue. And the logistics company fulfilled it and went through with it. And when someone's on the radio crying wolf, you're going to go out there and you're going to make sure that the wolf is taken care of. And then subsequently, back at your sheep, yeah. I mean, the goal is to shoot the wolf or whatever. We know the analogy I'm fishing for, but the hunting, yeah, we could. So afterwards, we got back and we're at the mess tent, and it was sort of. It wasn't a good thing, I saw it as being, because here they are walking around, and kind of like in Valerie Chamonix case, where, yeah, you could be down in 15 minutes having an espresso and a cup of tea. He decided to rescue himself. In this case, it wasn't being able to get out of there. You'd still have to walk the same distance to the nearest rescue station. You can't walk to the South Pole and expect the U.S. Antarctic Program to rescue you. They do not like recreation down there, so they're very explicit about don't come looking to us for a rescue. What it amounted to was saying, calling for rescue to get the insurance company to foot the bill rather than saying, we're in over our heads, we're behind schedule, we can't make it back, so it's going to cost us $50,000 or $60,000 to get us out. It affects the sport, it affects the insurance business, it's not a healthy thing, and I took an objection to it.
One of the continuing themes that we're talking about and also has been talked about in the web coverage of this issue is the question about the responsibility that we have to our rescuers. And that's partly the don't cry wolf scenario that you're talking about, Conrad. I wonder, Tim, if you could comment on what you think as a rescue safety person, what you want climbers and other adventurers to think about before they call for a rescue in terms of our responsibilities.
It's not very often that somebody around here is calling for help when they don't need it. So the number of stories that I can tell you where that's not the case, or I could count them on one hand maybe, and they're pretty funny, but we don't have time for them.
One, anyways.
it's ancient history, but a guy sends out one of the old registration slip from the Egypt Lake cabin one year with another party, and on the edge of this piece of paper, which is mostly printing, he's written a little message that says, I have broke my ski right in half and need a rescue. And then it said, P.S., I need to be out by Thursday. And we had the same reaction in the coffee room. And we discussed what we would do about it, and including flying over with a helicopter and bombing the guy with a sack of instant rice with a message taped to it, or I guess tied to it, saying, see you in the spring. the semi-serious part of that is, yeah, but we went anyway, because what if he sat there and waited and we didn't come, and then he would turn into a problem. So we found an old pair of skis to take in there. They were Attenhofer's, which were about 8 feet long and weighed about 20 pounds, and he did manage to make his way out. We didn't fly him out. We said, if you want to fly out. In fact, I said to him, the pilot told me, let me deal with him. And so we flew in there, and the door on the hut sort of opened just a crack, and then it closed, and he was taking a peek to see that the helicopter was actually landing, and it was. And so the pilot said, tell him to come and see me. I went inside, and the guy was madly stuffing stuff in his pack and, you know, sleeping bag and everything. And I said, so what's the matter? And he said, well, didn't you get my message? I said, yeah. And I said, but what's the problem? and he said, well, I broke my ski, see? And he picks up this garbage ski that was made out of like a styrofoam and flexes it the middle and to show me that it was useless and he couldn't do anything with it. And I go, well, you could take the binding off, couldn't you? And just move it ahead and you'd have one short ski and one long ski or something. And he looks at me like, yeah, but. So I said, go out and talk to the pilot. And the pilot, he went out to see Jim Davies and Jim opened the window and the blades were still turning. So it was a bit noisy. And I told him that you're going to have to pay if you want to fly out. This is, we're not running a babysitting service. And so he leaned in the window and over the noise of the helicopter, he said, how much? And Jim Davies said, for you, $900. And this was about 15 or 20 years ago. So that was sort of like, that'd be about 10 grand now, you know. So I helped him fix the skis and go out. And what was your question?
That's okay. Over here. Got a first question on the audio.
So Tim's story kind of directly to my point. Has rescue insurance, especially in Europe, kind of turned rescue into a baby service? Because then you paid for it, you can call, and I'm kind of glad we don't have that here, but what's the difference in rescue, the attitude that climbers take towards rescue when they are insured versus when they aren't? Thanks.
I couldn't tell you what it is. I don't know if there's been research on it, but and the situation, honestly, it varies from place to place a whole lot. In general terms, sure, you can get insurance or it's free or, it's cheap in places like Europe. Here, it's not exactly free. You're paying for it when you buy your park entry pass. That's one of the streams of the revenue that looks after rescue. So it is we think of it as a kind of an insurance thing. It's, everybody shares it. And the other thing, by the way, an old message is that not all the rescue in the park, by a long ways, and we were just looking at the other statistics, some other statistics this morning, are for climbers, believe it or not. Banff Park or the Mountain National Parks, the statistics would be of the people that we actually go out and help. Climbers, mountaineers, real like that, would be somewhere in the range of 20%. Some years. In other places, it's even less than that. And in McKinley, it was ridiculous. You think that's all they do is, because that's all you hear about is the climber rescue stuff, but all the other stuff, just who cares about it? But they're running around, and that's what's actually happening. But I keep losing my train of thought here.
Over here.
Yes, this question is for Barry. Reflecting on the incident that you told us about, do you feel there's you have a responsibility to the other people on your team, because if you decided to go the self-rescue route, would that not have imposed potential consequences on your teammates? For getting you out if something went wrong or complicated their getting out?
Yeah, I think climbing with the guys that I climb with in those situations, I mean, these are guys that I love and love like brothers and know so well that, it's, you have no consideration like that at all. You know, you help each other. You're signed in for the whole nine yards, and you come to each other's aid as much as possible, and you do whatever it takes to help each other. Having said that, the radio was in my hand when it worked, and one guy was up in an anchor, and another guy was down off the end of a rappel rope. So at that point in time, it was very much my decision, and I don't know, I guess it was kind of snatching of an opportunity, and I didn't think about it a whole bunch more than just pausing and thinking, yep, and calling for help.
Well, they liked you too, and they weren't on the shouting at you, tell them no, tell them no.
Well, they might have raised an argument for no, but they didn't know, it was kind of they didn't really know that the radio was working or what was going on, so it was very much my decision.
Of course, the other corollary to that is how you helped them. Barry's rescue allowed Scott Backes to clip his big pack onto Barry's butt when Barry got flowing out, and he's just like, okay.
The eternal opportunist. I won't have to carry this clip.
Another question over here.
I guess this question is more for Conrad. I'm wondering, it seems obviously frustrating in light of the rescue that everybody's talking about. And as Tim mentioned, it's probably going to be more and more inevitable that people rely on that or at least have it in the back of their mind. Is it enough for you, and I guess for the rest of you as well, to have a resume that is without such rescues and to know in yourself, but to know for yourself that maybe you're a little bit more of a true alpinist and more of a true climber? Or is it just exceedingly frustrating, and is there anything you could do about it?
Good question. I think a rescue is something that we don't want to plan. We never plan for it. We never want it to happen. But when it happens and it's called for, it is a miracle. And you're super, super thankful for it. And as Barry said, anytime someone in your community is absent, there leaves a big hole. The financial people put the value of how much money you earn over your life and all these things. But that aside, it's the emotional cost to your families. And I wouldn't see it as one way or the other that, oh, I've had more or less accidents that required a rescue. I mean, there are people I know that have had that have been rescued two or three times in the Alaska range. And a better example of that was in 95. I was on Denali with my late friend and partner Alex Lowe, and we were doing rescue, and we rescued a group of Taiwanese off the summit plateau at Denali. And they'd split up, classic error to do, you should stick together. They're in a storm. The strong guys went down, and they were just there. One guy descended the Messner couloir in a cartwheel type fashion, and another guy froze on top of the summit plateau, and there's two guys remaining that were alive. And Alex and I carried them down to 17,000 feet. They were put in a helicopter and they left. The leader of that expedition was Makalu Gao, and that was the warm-up for his climb of Everest in 1996. And he was then, on the May 10th disaster that happened, came down, and he was the first person to be rescued with the helicopter out of the Western Coom, followed by Beck Weathers. And obviously the guy didn't get it. You'd hope that after one rescue you would see that it's not the style of climbing that you want to be doing, and you're putting other people's lives at great risk. But I'm not going to pass judgment one way or the other if someone has had a rescue. And if they genuinely need it and they're honest about it, then it's not something I would hold against them. But to have something, as I pointed out in my opening statement, where your website, one, says how strong you are, and secondly, that the opportunity for a rescue is the fact that you can't be a rescue is part of the beauty that you are there for, and then within a 12-hour period you're calling for a rescue, then that's probably less than ideal style.
I'd like to hear what all of you might think about this or these series of events and occasions as being a case of inflation in climbing. You're all known for climbing in good style. Is it now going to be more difficult? Is like a big mountain accomplishment, going light, fast, going by yourself, going to be worth less because everybody else knows, well, you know, I mean, if he's only got a little bit of water in his pack and no stove, still someone can go get him. It also sort of seems to be an issue developing on a bigger scale. Some meetings I was at, the UIA meetings last month, the Nepal Mountaineering Association is trying to bring censure, possibly suit, and definitely the weight of international law against the French company that landed the helicopter on top of Everest, because the Nepalese now say that a certain element of their tourist lifeblood has been devalued because it's, now that there's been an aircraft on the top, it's no longer the thing it once was in the world's mind.
Anybody want to grab that?
What is it in the world's mind? That's a good question. I think that it's interesting, back to what's written in the program here, the Humar thing, and I've heard that that's going to be treated by American press in a couple prominent magazines and have articles and that stuff done. And it just blows me away that all of this stuff is going around Thomas's screw up. And you have Steve House and Vince Anderson probably doing the greatest American ascent ever in the Himalaya. You know, Unsolden Hornbein traversing Everest, John Ross Kelly going to the top of Makalu after climbing the French Pillar with three other guys. And then this is, you know, it's amazing. It's an incredible ascent. It's done in immaculate style. And to take it a little bit more, it's kept pure by the grant process. These guys applied for a grant to go to the climb, came up with the money themselves, kind of thing. And they didn't take all that stuff to base camp. And I think that type of expression will exist. It still exists. It exists in this range, even though we have a very formalized kind of organized rescue thing, and we can land on top of any of the mountains here. I don't know. Does that help?
Jerry.
Jeff, I just have a comment. I can't speak about mountaineering, but I can speak about polar travel. And in 1983, when I was doing my first expedition, I was the subject of a rescue. And it was certainly embarrassing, and it made me feel miserable. And so I went home, and I wanted to see if I... First of all, I hoped it was not going to happen again next year. And so I wanted to see if I could waive my right to rescue. And I was told that I couldn't, that the right to be rescued is a constitutional one, and you can't waive it any more than you can waive your right not to be murdered. And so then I did what writers do, and I did a magazine story about search and rescue. And I was trying to kind of make myself feel better. And I found out that the money that was spent on my rescue didn't come out of social security, or it didn't come out of healthcare. Search and rescue has a budget. And the search and rescue people told me that if they hadn't spent it rescuing me, they would have spent it flying circles doing practice rescues. I mean, that's no excuse to be rescued, but it's still, it's a point. And the second thing that they told me was that the number of adventurers who are rescued, particularly in the polar regions, are extremely rare. I mean, I think it's like once every 5 years or once every 10 years. And that the biggest abuse of search and rescue is the casual, say, for example, a fisherman who drops off to a bar at an outport and doesn't tell his family, and his family gets worried and calls search and rescue. Or a family that has their four-year-old wander off into the woods, and then there's search and rescue there. So just to address Valeri's point about the growing technology and feeling a little bit too much at home out there, you can choose not to bring a sat phone and not to bring that technology. And it changes the nature of the experience, and I'd argue that it increases the degree of difficulty psychologically, just like going unsupported and not having airdrops or caches increases the degree of difficulty physically.
Thanks. Tim, I wonder if you could comment on, maybe you brought this up before, the question of who the rescues are actually for as maybe one way of addressing Jerry's question as to why you can't wave a rescue off.
Jerry, where are you from? I'm not sure what you mean by a constitution. That's interesting, but I'm not aware of anything like that in Canada. But the reality of it is that, and what Jeff's referring to is the obvious, and that's that when somebody goes missing, there's usually somebody out there who cares, and what can you say to them? And what are you going to do? In other words, it's mom and dad or whatever. And so you have a responsibility to go and look, even if the guy left a message saying, don't come for me, you just go, isn't this what we all do? Wouldn't you? Is you just go, because what if he changes his mind? I mean, around here, it's just somebody's going to probably try and go if somebody asks us to do it. And if you really want to go out and hide, yeah, you can do it. That is true, Like you say, don't take the phone and don't tell anybody where you're going and all the rest. You'll probably cause a lot of trouble because we have this knee-jerk reaction and we still go, don't we? Fly around and look and sometimes don't find them.
Yeah, I think the way you framed it the other day, as describing that the rescue, when a mother calls in and says, my daughter is missing, the rescue is equally of the mother as it is of the daughter. Yeah. Right. Another question here.
I have a fairly similar experience like Valeri on the north face of the Grand Jurasse, and overdue, and somebody called rescue, and I wasn't, and we actually had a cell phone, and you could actually call from there and call the rescue right there, and my partner actually wanted to, and he was from Chamonix and stuff. We got off of it 3 days late, and I ended up in the hospital for a few days, frostbite and stuff. And And the whole time there was a helicopter on the French side, a helicopter on the Italian side, and I could have been rescued. So obviously it seems from what's developed is that the responsibility lies in the alpinist and not the rescue service, because the rescue service is going to knee-jerk reaction, they're automatically going to go out. I felt greater from my experience for getting myself off, kind of gave me more training in the sense of how to survive something like that when you go to the further ranges like the Himalayas. And now that this is happening in the Himalayas, obviously they're going to be having the same knee-jerk reaction to going and rescue someone. But without the institution or the technology to perform the rescue properly, should there be any, you know, the responsibility being the alpinist in saying, no, I mean, it's going to endanger their lives more than my life, in a sense, by them just coming out and doing it because their institutions aren't properly trained, you know, their people aren't properly trained, you know, whose responsibility is it in say, Nepal or Pakistan, where it's they don't have, obviously, the training like we do here?
It's a really hard one to answer. I know for myself, until you're in the situation, and, you know, I'll say one thing here. I could put on the brave hat and say, you know, no, I'm going to just say it's too much risk to those gentlemen. I'm going to perish here. But that hat may change at the time. It's I don't have the willpower to say that I am going to, you know, act this way, because I've been to that place and I know that I acted differently. And I feel good about acting differently. And the question about rescue on the resume, you know, we're out there trying to go through this process of climbing mountains and learn what we can from it. And I don't think too much in terms of resumes, more in challenges and beautiful faces that really call to you. I think if there is a that terrible word, failure, on my resume, it's the fact that really it was the decision to climb up into the storm. That was a failure. That was a bad decision, and I paid a price for it, and my partners paid somewhat of a price for it too, and we all made a bad decision.
I'll just say one last thing, because it keeps coming back to my mind, and that's about Humar. And if style-wise, he might the next time think that when he gets in the ship to the point where he really does want to call, he probably switch off the PR machine and just, you know, let's deal with that later. He'd come back. And but the fact that you're sort of, it's a continuing part of your show, and that you just, it becomes the entertainment thing, and that's when you begin to get kind of antsy about it, I think.
Real quick comment here on Dave's observation about the helicopter on Mount Everest, and I think it's indication of the strength of helicopters, and we know how advanced technology is, particularly in the mechanical world. In 1953, Everest was climbed for the first time. 16 years later, which isn't even a generation, we went to the moon. So given our prowess with engineering and everything, there's no feat that we can't do. And we definitely need to draw lines and limit ourselves if we want to preserve mountain wilderness and the adventure that it brings to us. And I take objection to landing the helicopter on the summit. I was in Lukla, which is the airport they were staging out of, and the helicopter was there, and there was, I could see it was a different type of helicopter, and they had special fuel, and they're all about just their little mission, but they really weren't integrated with the people there. And for the people that live on both sides of Mount Everest, or Chomolungma is the name that it is given, the mother goddess of the earth, it's a deity for them, it's a god, and they don't even put the foot of the sole of their feet on the top of the mountain. So if you imagine something as filthy and polluting as a helicopter landing up there, I was really dismayed. It took a lot away from what that mountain stood for. And I agree with the people of Nepal saying, well, they've debased something that's really important to us.
I wonder if we could close up with, if you folks would be up to this, trying to answer one question that I think kind of addresses the fact that a lot of what's happening with the Humar incident is reactive to the fact that he got rescued, but there is an opportunity here perhaps for being proactive about what we want to try and do about the situation as a community, and that's the question about, the Pakistanis have now said that in the aftermath of this rescue that they want to up their efforts to try and have an organized rescue service in the in their part of the Himalaya. As climbers, if you were asked to give them some advice about whether they should organize that rescue service or not, or what parameters it should have, what would you like to say to them? What advice do you want to give to them?
I'd say work on the disaster that really counts, and look after your own people first, and look after us, the visitors, second.
Give them the advice. I think it's a great thing, and it happened here. You know, that evolution happened with our mountain community here in the 50s and 60s when the helicopter was introduced to mountain rescue. And I would encourage them to hire gentlemen like Tim Auger to haul them out of retirement and teach them how to do it.
But you wouldn't say don't do it. Don't have it.
I don't think it can be said now. It's been done, and my first comments, I think it's there's no going back.
Okay. Conrad?
Back to what Tim said. I mean, here we are, we've spent this amount of mental energy and how much postings on the internet, and there was requests for funding to help pay for it, and then 6 weeks later there's an earthquake, 60,000 people are dead, and millions of people are homeless going into the winter. And we have greater issues that we need to address than the frivolous pursuit of some adventures being up in the mountains. That being said, if I see someone that's with a flat tire on the side of the road in the middle of nowhere, then you certainly stop and you go to help them out. And it comes back to human nature to help out. And perhaps the Pakistanis, in a way, they might have seen this reflecting positively on them, that how well prepared their military was, how good their pilots are, and that there was a certain degree of pride associated with it. And similarly, that if they have a better and more skilled rescue team, then it pays off in other areas.
Closing advice to you, Valeri?
I think if we have some possibility for use something, it will be good. But sure, we can lose some adventure, but maybe we can keep somebody alive. So, I don't know.
Another one of those really complicated kind of questions that I think is exactly the reason why we have these panels. And I want to thank all the panelists for coming to discuss this difficulty, and all of you folks for coming as well. Thanks very much.